Hi, welcome to How to Repair. Have you ever wondered how selector switches are made? Well, I've been travelling through Europe now on a busman's holiday and I've eventually arrived at a factory called Gottak. Gottak manufacture over 10 million selector switches per year. Daniel, the owner of the company, has invited me to spend 10 days with him at the factory, showing me not only how the selector switches are made, but also how the injection moulding system produces the pieces that are needed to assemble the selector switches. Also, we're going to be going onto the shop floor where the assembly takes place. The staff work in harmony with robotics, and some of the robots they've even named. We have Tom and Jerry here, who are part of the assembly process that puts the cam into the selector switches. Let's go down into the injection moulding plant to have a look. Okay, I'm over here at the Gottak's main injection moulding plant, where they make the components for your selector switch. You have the cam, which opens and shuts points in different position, and you have the body, and the body is what holds all the contacts. They use two materials here, polyamide, which is used up to about 150 degrees, and bakelite, which is used at higher temperature ranges, I believe up to 200 degrees. What we're gonna do is just have a quick walk around, have a look at how these little things are made and how many millions are made. Because you have to remember, Gottak actually have over 5,000 different type of profiling systems which make up these selector switches. Not just for cookers and ovens and things like that, they also make switches for light fittings and many other products as well. Okay, first thing we have here is the actual raw product itself. And the raw product has to go through a drying process to eliminate any water in the actual plastics. The first stage is the actual drying process of the actual raw material. And we have great big machines that not only dry all the actual material, and if we have a look here at some of the raw material, you can see this is ready to actually be heated and then pushed into the injection moldings. From here, it is dried, and then it goes up through a tube system all the way across to the actual machines. Let's have a look at some of the machines. Okay, here's one of the injection molding systems, and this is what this injection molding system is making. You have the cam and also the extract. Now, the extract goes into a machine and is just basically broken off. This is then reground and reused, because this is a waste otherwise. And then you end up with a perfect cam profile for the actual selector switch that this is being made for. The way it works is the raw material, the granules that you saw earlier, come down into the machine. They are then heated into a liquid and then pushed into the actual mold. There's also some auxiliary heaters to keep the actual liquid warm as it goes through the mold system. And at the other end, you'll see the actual cam come out of the machine. And here you can actually see the products and the extract being separated. And they come out at quite a rate, but you must remember that they're producing millions of switches per year. And there you go, that's the injection molding side of the business. We'll now go over to the main factory to have a look at how these are all put together. Okay, just come over from the injection molding after having a fantastic lunch. I'm truly being spoiled here in Barcelona, and I'm lucky enough that they've got a large run on at the moment. They're actually manufacturing for a customer, which I can't mention, approximately 10,000 of these selector switches. These selector switches are predominantly used on cookertops for the solid state plates, or they're used on top oven applications or main oven applications, depending on the configuration. Let me quickly explain what this selector switch does. It's a six pole, as I said, one off position and five separate positions as you rotate the selector switch round. It has nine terminals on it all together, and it basically controls the different temperature ranges on the ring or the different positions for functionality on the oven. We have got two sides to the assembly here. We have the finishing process on this side, and also the contact assembly on this side. And I'm going to take you through the whole process of the assembly. First, we have the extracts for the actual configuration on the actual terminals, which has to be cut by one of the robots. This is cut according to the design of the selector switch. This then goes onto the rotational table that you can see, and we will have a look at how all this is loaded with individual machines. The casings are loaded into the conveyor belt, which goes down to the robot at the far end that loads the springs into the casings before it goes into the assembly line for the points. As you can see here, the conveyor belt pushes down the casings, and this then pushes it out to the robot, which then lifts it onto the turntable where this spring assembly takes place. The springs are actually hidden underneath the bakelite part here and the point connection. And the actual contacts have a little spring underneath them which lift up and down according to the cam position. As I wander over to the main point assembly system, which is one of these multiple turntables that they have that controls the actual assembly of all the contacts, not only the spade connectors you can see here, but also these very, very minute point contacts. Now, this is one of the reasons why selector switches are so expensive. This company uses 1 kilo of silver, pure silver, every 8 hours. And this is just one bag I'm bringing up for you here. This carries, I'm not too sure how many is in here, but shall we say there's a heck of a lot of them. Now, if we have a closer look inside here, what actually happens is this machine rotates and sorts all these little contacts out. And in a second, you'll see this rotating. The technology here is truly amazing. Not only does the main computer system detect whenever a component is not built to standard and reject it, it also, if it spots it more than one occasion, it will send the engineer to the appropriate area so that that may be inspected in case something is malfunctioning during a production run. This allows Gottak to actually produce 100% perfection on all their production runs. I must thank everyone at Gottak for their generosity and hospitality. I've put many a kilo on with all these 2-hour lunches that they take in this country, but I have really enjoyed the experience. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. It did take me quite a while to put together, so please remember to like and subscribe to the channel. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, please remember to hit the notification button. Thanks very much indeed for watching.